Hello, Yokosuka, Ikego, Parts Unknown, people on YouTube, Captain Dave Glenister, Massive Marty King, hopefully some people on YouTube, because we don't get a lot of hits, it doesn't seem like, on our website. So this is Commander's Corner. We're going to take some of your ICE comments, news you can use. These are the ICE comment system is where you put your input into this big database that you can hit any installation you want. You're on travel and you get bad service somewhere else. Or you're on TAD back in the States, you can use the same ICE system, pull down the menu to the installation, find the organization, say, I have a comment to make, good service, bad service, otherwise. And then we actually put the information back in the system. So even if you don't put your name in, which please put your name in, otherwise you'll never know what happens, we comment on these, and we have now a record of your complaint or your comment or your BZ you're putting out to somebody else, and then our response to it. So we're going to go through some of these. It's been a while. Kind of post-holidays. Some of these are kind of old, but a lot of these are personal service type stuff. And I don't know if that's because, you know, over the holidays, people are stressed, less time. There's two ways of being stressed, right? There's your personal stress of your anxiety, but then you also are stressing the system, right? We stress our parking lots by filling them up, right? You have now stressed the limits of that. And you've stressed the limits of customer service in the next because everybody has everything on layaway or return or everything else. So lines are longer. Frustrations can be higher. So there was a lot of personal comments from the in the December time frame and some BZs. So I kind of we're not going to go through a lot of those type of things because a lot of those were handled and answered to you as to how this piece of customer service went your way or did not. And thank you for the positive comments and thank you for the negative comments and we'll research them. But sometimes you will just won't know. If you don't put your contact information, you won't know. And if you were actually wronged because you got mayonnaise when you asked for no mayonnaise or something, and sometimes when the manager can't reach out to you, and sometimes you know they try to do it right by you by giving you a, you know 50% off your next burger or whatever it is. So, by all means, please put your contact information. Sometimes we need to follow up. There's a few things we want to put out there. Nope, there are some comments these will relate to. But Ikego, home to work. Right now we have over the holidays again. Most of the fleet is in. Of the 10,200-ish active duty sailors. About 2,000 are permanent party shore for hospital, SRF, NAVFAC, CFA, and some others. About 8,000-ish are afloat. And that is kind of a varying population. So obviously a lot of them live on base or off base. A lot, most of them are single or non-accompanied sailors. But we do have Kago filling up. We do have a lot of folks here. And so the home-to-work bus has been rather full lately. So in fact, we had some people who could not get on it. So we are adding a microbus to the 5:30 run. That's the 0530 run, using military time. So you have a main bus comes, and we're going to have a little microbus behind it. So to catch up some of those other folks, we've been between 7 and 9, I think we've been missing, depending on the day and the time.
Because we track every bus every day. The bus that has been overcrowded from Kago to here has been the 5:30 run. So based on those numbers, we think the microbus will fill it. And PW is going to track that for a period of time to see what else we need to do, if we can.
Yeah. I was going to say, you may have to start becoming a volunteer bus rider on the school bus system for all those high schoolers and middle schoolers that leave Ikego to go to the main base and got to be at school at a certain time anyway. You still arrive on time, and you get to have the pleasure of riding with the kids. After all, they get to ride our home-to-work bus on space.
There is another option. The train at Jimanji Station actually starts running at 5:10.
Oh, is that what time? We were looking that one up. Yeah. So you can do that one as well. And I know it's colder. People don't want to walk. So we are going to try and solve this problem for now. Add the microbus. Make sure we can do all this on the up and up. We actually have a waiver to run this bus at all from CNIC, Commander Navy Installations Command. The people where the money flows to the shore side. So anyway, that's some good news for you there. Super Bowl Monday coming up. We have canceled AOB for that day, so people can actually go see that. We have things going on in the theaters.
And what else we have going on? It's Monday.
Theaters, all three of our clubs have events going on involving foods and entertainment areas. I believe that our MWR director, people can bring their children to watch the event.
Yeah, we're going to have, like, I think we're going to do the wristbands, so you can tell if you are of legal drinking age for those things, places that will sell alcoholic beverages. And we're going to try, that actually came from, I think, Army Navy game, or somebody had that recommendation, because, you know, sometimes we do these things at clubs or smaller venues, or actually where we serve alcohol, and, you know, it was a good idea from one of you, so thank you very much. So we're going to do that as well.
Yes, sir. But there's a lot of stuff going on, moving parts, so get out. Take advantage of what MWR has to offer, not just for the Super Bowl, but every day.
Yeah, they are trying to do right by you, give you things to do. Opportunity in the wintertime. It's not time to go hibernate. It's time to go take advantage of some of those cool things in Japan. You know, Nagano, big, you know, Olympic Village type of, you know, scale of ski winter resort type thing. And also seeing the snow monkeys, which I have not done. It's on the bucket list sometime. You know, and actually, you can Google snow monkeys, and you'll see a monkey with someone's cell phone that they stole in a hot spring, and some other things, like some neat things that are out there worth doing. And next, we have some comments I'm probably not going to go through about, you know, just do your research into some of these places, right? So if you think it may say there's sledding available. I never really skied until I was actually I pre-commissioned Fitzgerald in Maine, where there's a lot of snow for a lot of the year. So you go to some of, that's where I first started doing it. So you go to some of these resorts, and might say, hey, there's sledding available, but it's like a small section of the Bunny Hill only. It really is a ski resort, and they kind of have that for some of the folks. So do some of your homework before you do one of these things, so you're not disappointed as you kind of thought you'd have this, you know, winter wonderland. It turns out it's really a snowboarder hangout. So, okay, some other things going on, or some things I want to bring your attention to. One is the YES program, Yokosuka Enhanced Spouse Sponsorship. It falls under Fleet and Family, and it is where we have you folks, spouses who have been here, gone through the process, volunteer to help out an inbound spouse. Maybe it's on emails and phone. Maybe you take them out for coffee. Maybe the first week or two they're here, you drive them around before they get their car. But it's another layer of sponsorship, and over 700 people have gone through it. And we're looking for volunteers to help do that, particularly in Akago, and civilians. So there's different challenges. We try to match people up, like a match.com. So if you are a male spouse who has a school-aged child and a dog, we'll try to match you up with someone like that who can take you around and show you the lay of the land, because there are different challenges and different things. Where we are kind of looking for more people is civilians, right? Because there are different challenges to being a GS than there is being a military member to coming here, particularly with TRICARE and some other issues. And also living out in Akago. As Akago starts to fill up, we have more people out there, more new people going there. So it's just be more convenient. So if you have been a beneficiary of this program, or even if you got here before the program existed and you want to help out and kind of pay it forward, YESS. You can Google that, Yokosuka Enhanced Spouse Sponsorship, and become a YES mentor. So it'd be great. We have seen a little bit of an uptick Navy-wide, all over the place. In the use of over-the-counter drugs, right? Things like DXM, which, you know, cough syrup, and some of those other ones. There has been a slight uptick in shoplifting associated with that as well, and there are some folks who are going to be getting in trouble for that. Actually, you'll find out, because I've already signed out how much trouble you got into. You just don't know it yet. As you go up to the civilian administrative form for these kind of things. And it's not just, you know, if you think it's a bunch of school-age kids who are shoplifting it and popping them to get high in school, well, that sometimes is part of the problem. But it's not. We have had sailors in the United States Navy who have been separated for pattern of misconduct and gotten a mask for this thing, for DXM. So this is something to be aware of as parents, something to be aware of in the community. You see your buddy's locker or your friend's barracks room, and she happens to have, you know, bottle after bottle of this stuff or all the pills and stuff. You know, this is an area of concern. People are heading into danger for their careers, for themselves, just like you would, you know, if they had a broken glass collection on the floor. You'd say, that's a dangerous thing. You may want to, you know, take care of that. These are dangerous behaviors as well, and folks tend to, you know, are on the wrong path. You want to help set them on the right path. So if you know this behavior is out there, you try and get these people some help, all right, whether you are a parent, whether you are a friend, shipmate, whatever. So. But it has got the attention, and periodically does, right? Sometimes the whole Navy, we rip all these things off the shelf, we make them controlled like cigarettes, And then, you know, we do education of behavior. But it's, yes, it's bad behavior, but more importantly, you're putting yourself at risk with these things. So keep an eye out for that kind of stuff. Just for parents and everyone else, know that that's out there. We're trying to do our best to kind of, you know, get a handle on it. Hopefully you should too. Let's see here. We have had some issues with behavioral stuff out in town. Sometimes it's transiting sailors, right? And so I say that because you folks who live here all the time, this is your home, are doing great, right? This is your home, right? So you don't, you know, it's not just one long port visit. But so sometimes you have folks that come to your command that are only here for a short period of time. Maybe they're here visiting en route somewhere else. Maybe they're going to a school. Maybe they're doing maintenance. But I encourage you to bring them into the fold. Okay, make them, like anyone, it doesn't matter how long they're here. We have actually had sailors of the quarter from CFE who were limited duty sailors.
Yes.
They are here. They become part of our command while they're waiting. And they do such a great job. You know, they are part of our command. We don't, you know, they may be TAD, but hey, that does not mean you cannot be the best sailor we have. And we have done that sometimes. And so I encourage all the commands, everyone, to bring all these people in the fold. And that includes also when you're going to go hang out and you meet some other folks, you know, you who are here all the time and kind of understand the strategic importance of this relationship, you know, kind of reach out to some of those folks that you're working with and remind them and help them to remember that this is our home. And that when it's like, you know, you get that house guest who trashes the place, your apartment complex, you know, you still live there, and it kind of gives us all kind of a black eye. So I think the best way to handle that is bring all these people in to be part of our family here in Yokosuka, and I'm sure that the behavioral stuff will go up as well because they'll feel more at ease. Okay. And finally, a note on Starbucks.
Yes. So we're going to we did get a nice comment about Starbucks, and it was not about the service or the products. It was about the condition of some of the furniture and flooring that was in there. Since that is in ice, we actually, of course, did the research, and we're going to be going in and doing a remodel of Starbucks, not to affect operations. So at night when it's closed, we're going to have workers in there replacing the furniture, replacing the flooring, and we're going to have a nice looking better Starbucks.
Starbucks is a good success story for us because they subsist out of Starbucks Japan. They wanted to pull out of the base because it's not as profitable. You got a Starbucks right outside Daiei Gate. You got a Starbucks down the street there. So we made some arrangements with them and said, yes, you may only take yen. Yes, we'll work with Army Public Health to allow you to use your ingredients and things from here. And it's been a big success story that we've allowed them to remain here. I would have made a nice comment about their furniture, and I'm probably only one, but you know their little the checker chess tables that they have there?
Yes.
They've got reversed videoed it. So like the dark squares are not the ones that you play with. It's very hard to see those things. I know I'm the only nerd in here that probably brings my chess pieces and uses that as I force march my kids over there for coffee and garbage cleanup. But yeah, so I would say let's get on board with that thing. I don't know. Maybe we'll have a chess tournament sometime. 96 Hour Liberty if you can beat me.
Yeah.
I don't know. We'll see. Okay, let's hop to it. All right, so this is one that goes out to PSD. And it is, I think it's relevant to a lot of folks here, certainly to me. So it says, my wife had a baby at Yokosuka Hospital in September. Congratulations. You know, September births, though, you know, you got to be careful, not careful, but in the military as we move around, a September and October birth, sometimes you fall in between school years.
Right.
Yes and no. So that's something that you don't care about it now, but you may have to deal with that. So that's okay. You know, my vote is, although we always want to push our kids forward into the next grade up, there is sometimes an advantage to having them in the lower grade where they will be the first picked during recess for any athletic event, the tallest in their class, and think of it this way, they'll be able to drive themselves to high school a year earlier if you do that. So, but anyway, congratulations on the birth of your child there. During the process of getting birth certificates, social security guards and passports required to keep my family in Japan, the Yokosuka PSD provided little to no support. There's no one attached to PSD that deals with tourist passports. So, and it goes on to more of the details of how they went and did some of the things here. So, so I kind of went through this many years ago. My youngest son, Brendan, is now 11, just turned 11. So we went through this as well, born at Naval Hospital. So actually you don't get a birth certificate. You get a certificate of live birth abroad. Which you may actually know in the news now because there's being a challenge of is someone eligible for a presidency since the Constitution says you have to be born in the United States. Yes. And yes, you can, is what I think that the Supreme Court has said. Yes, certificate of live birth abroad, since you're born a U.S. citizen, yes, you may run for president. But it's not the same as a birth cert. You can't get another copy of it, so please be careful with that thing. We had to mail off a lot of the documentation to, it's not an easy process. And I acknowledge that. You got to work closely with the embassy. We are fortunate we are so close to Tokyo that you can do that. But Social Security cards and those things. But the issue is this. No, PSD does not do tourist passports because that is not PSD's problem. No-fee passports, traveling for the government is their bag, and they will work on that. But your tourist passport is on you because you're not here as a tourist, nor do they care. I mean, of course, they care because they're sailors and they're people, and they probably do it themselves. And we used to actually do a run where, because they were going up to the embassy to do things, but they don't do that. But you know, you can. Now, being it's their first passport, you can't do this one, but you can renew by mail, right? But you can make an appointment online at the embassy. You go up there, and you go through the line, and you get your passport. And that's kind of what you have to do. And then, of course, the certificate of live birth abroad. So in my particular case, we had the unique challenge slash opportunity that many of you may have, where my wife Helen at the time was a citizen of the Republic of Ireland. So not that there's a dual citizenship case. By the way, the United States generally does not recognize dual citizenship. Other countries do. Okay, but the United States, for extradition and legal purposes, will say, no, you're an American. You're coming back. So just so you know. But in trying to get a passport, there's opportunities to get it through different countries or to, in this case, you could put it on your Irish passport. And no longer, she's an American citizen now. But there are challenges with that. And it takes time. And you need to start right away. Absolutely, you need to start right away. Having a child overseas presents unique issues to you. For single sailors or even married sailors, when you have a child here, getting the command sponsorship paperwork going right away is essential. And if you don't do it in the first 90 days, you run the risk of them not going retroactive to the birth for things like dependent BAH and COLA, but rather to the day you applied. So, for all these things, my advice is apply right away. It is administratively challenging at times. And PSD does not do tourist passports. Those are all the comments I want you to take away. Right? Tourist passport is totally on you. Right? And just like it is totally on any American citizen living in America. Right? Other folks, just they don't go to their place of business and have them help it out. You download the forms. Everything's available on the internet. Right? DS-11, I think it is. Is the form for passport application, pretty sure. Okay, so please, and all the rest of the comments, I think that you know, those person were handled there. Okay, so moving on to my gotta have one, AmeriCable comment. For the amount paid for services, the speed and performance of the internet service is poor. Okay, and we've gone through this a lot of times, but I just want to reiterate that there's a finite amount of bandwidth for the entire base. And 15% of the people are using 60% of the bandwidth. On base, because we've gotten to that age where everybody's streaming. Why wait for the show to come up when I can just download it or stream it or do whatever? Now, so I would encourage some folks, be a good neighbor, okay? There are ways that you can, as you're downloading, capture and not have to download every time, because that's what some people do. Like, at least my kids, sometimes they will download the same thing and they're streaming this stuff. You wonder why you're reaching your 450 gigabyte limit. Is because your kids are watching the same episode of the same thing, and they're downloading it each time they do that, not playing from a cached version of it. Some other things, too, I want to talk about. So some services, I can't speak for all of them, but there's Hulu and there's Netflix and there's others, but things like Netflix, when you pay them, they also throttle the speed with which they send it. So sometimes, if you have multiple devices going, like I think Netflix, your standard package, you can have two. And if you are watching something, your kids have a tablet or something they're streaming, and plus another, the PS4 is streaming something, somebody is going to be unsatisfied that they can't watch. So, but there are other packages with those streaming companies, and they throttle, it's actually quality of service, what they call it, right? Video quality and stuff like that. And of course, you can throttle back down. You can be paying for HD for something that was not recorded in HD, and they're sending a lot of electrons and a lot of data your way, which is not improving the quality of picture. So you can certainly look at some of those things as well. But yes, I don't control AmeriCable. They're a private company. What I do control, or not even me, is the ability to try and solicit more competitors to come in, different options, and we are looking at that. It will not happen tomorrow, but it might happen in the next year or two. I don't mean to make false hope out there, but, you know.
You never know.
You never know. And if it takes 2 years, then if I start now, it'll be 2 years from now. If I start next year, it'll be 3 years from now. So we're trying to start now. Okay? So there you go. Let's see. So this is obviously an old comment, but I wanted to make something. It's about the home accent store. It's the first night of Hanukkah, and I don't have any candles for a family menorah for the first time. I realize I'm in the minority, but I don't expect a store full of Hanukkah items. But when you have multiple aisles of candles and hundreds of Christmas items, it'd be nice if we could make room for a few boxes of Hanukkah candles that fit into a menorah. So several comments with that. One is, as we have all learned, you know, sometimes you got to order early and order often online some of your things. Two is, you can go to the Nex and pre-order a lot of the things that are out there, and they can order them in for you. That's anything. If you have a special item, they can order that kind of stuff for you. And if there's a demand signal, they will start to stock the shelves. Third, we don't have these large warehouses where we can move things in and out. So we're kind of stuck with this conveyor belt type of system. Things come off the Yokohama, they go into our warehouses and into our stores. Where back in Conus, sometimes, especially Walmart, you might have these large warehouses where things come into the store and then back to a separate warehouse. You can move them back to the store based on user demand. We kind of just keep funneling it through here. Third, I feel your pain on this candle thing. And I will tell you, well, one, I grew up in I'm a Christian tradition, but I grew up in a Jewish neighborhood. And we had a Torah on the threshold of our door. We had most of my friends celebrate Hanukkah and stuff like that. I don't know the specifics of their specific Hanukkah candles that fit into your menorah, but I will tell you, I had a heck of a time trying to find tapers, candles of the right size. So one of the things that most of you folks know, I do some of these scouting type things, and we have our ceremonies. A lot of them are rooted in Native American type, and it's very dramatic, you know. Kids like fire. So we do, you know, light candles. And so we have these, you know, fire and face paint, very fun part of what we do. And I could not find colored taper candles. I was stunned, both at the Home Accent store and here. So, but what I have found, if you go out to like the Home store or some of the other stores in town, they do have, it's on based on millimeter size, a whole slew, at least if you're good with white candles, a whole slew of these things of different sizes, particularly at places like the Home Store, because they do them for kind of disaster preparedness. They have candles that are specially designed to burn for 12 hours, and they have ones that will burn very quickly and stuff like that. So a lot of times out in Japan, you might not find them in the decoration home side, but you might find them by the flashlights and the batteries and the bottles of water and the kind of disaster preparedness side. Japan has a big disaster preparedness mindset. They do major, big drills all the time. They've got areas for that. It goes back to the 1923 earthquake, which took Yokosuka and Tokyo down to parade rest. And ever since then, they still do those things. So they do have them out in town of many, many different sizes. I know sometimes if you don't bend, you break. And so you have to kind of be somewhat flexible. So they do have some of these things. So I encourage you to go out there and try and, you know, look around and see what they have. But yes, so the disaster preparedness kind of section of some of your stores is where you might find candles of many, many different diameters anyway. I could not find colored tapers, though. My oranges and greens and blues that, you know, you kind of ceremoniously do. So I understand exactly what you're talking about. Anyway, I know it's a past time, but happy Hanukkah, happy New Year to all our viewers here. It's the first one we've done in the New Year, right?
It is.
Okay. Let's see. Army vet facility needs staffing to support the volume of pets in the area. The hours and days have already been reduced, yet the number of pets did not. Actually, it's kind of gone up, I think. The staff works hard to support the customer need, yet they can't create more appointment slots. My producer says 5 minutes, so I can handle this one in 5 minutes. Okay, yes, so my Army of One, Army Captain Missy North, there's several folks in this Army detachment. They work, they're a detachment out of Camp Zama, which is Army Public Health Command, and they, not only do they work with a pet, so they're really here because we have our military working dogs. Primary function. Okay, they also survey all the kind of food and kind of like that USDA type of stuff, things that come into the base to make sure they haven't been tampered with, that they're safe, they're sanitary. They survey all the food services for all of our clubs, the galley, and all those They're part of work with industrial health in the hospital to do those things too. That's a big part of their job. And then, as an of opportunity, they help out with the 1,850-ish pets that we have registered here. But you know, you can go out in town, and they will encourage you to go out in town and go to a vet, because that's what everyone in America is doing. You know, there's no, maybe there is, but I never went to the vet on Naval Station San Diego or Naval Station Ingleside in these more remote places. So you have a pet, you sometimes have to go out in town, and they can help you with that. And we have a contracted veterinarian. It took her a little while to get online, because not only is she now a qualified vet because she's Japanese, but she had to get certified through the U.S. Army.
Yes.
Because it's the U.S. Army standards and procedures she had to follow. I Roger out. We don't have enough capacity for everyone to go through, but nor is that their primary mission. It is of opportunity that we do that. And you're a pet owner.
I am. And I actually think that if you go to the vet office, they actually have a list that will give you vets that are off the installation that are actually very close. And I'll tell you, having been to a couple of them, they are very user-friendly. And can accommodate you very quickly, same day, even late in the evening. So yes, our vet office has very limited people to be able to support it, which is why we have to rely on
host nation support. So, and also I would say shop around. Sometimes it may be cheaper to do your appointment out in town, but get your meds for your pets here, or vice versa. Like, always shop around, like life, right? Shop around and those things. And you know, if you're intimidated by going off base, don't be. The Japanese are not. Right. I mean, there's traffic lights and everything. Okay, just follow the traffic laws. It is not that big a deal. If you're new, here's a little little tip. Maybe tilt your mirrors down slightly so you can see the left and right sides of the lines that you're following. There's ways to try and teach yourself how to drive around here, but don't be intimidated by going off base. I mean, it's there's 400,000 people in Yokosuka that have no problem being in Yokosuka.
Yes.
So, yeah, I think I got time for maybe one more small one. And here it is, a small one. This is for the Benny Decker Theater. So please install. I think we should probably put some Benny Decker memorabilia in that thing. Yeah, you do a survey.
Yes.
If you did an exit survey, people leaving that thing and said, you know who Benny Decker is? Most people don't.
They don't.
And he's a personal hero and a professional hero here to people in Yokosuka. But that's not what the comment's about. I'll have to put one in there about that. Please install automated ticket vending machines at our base theaters. A door person at each entrance to the movie hall can take tickets to verify customers are authorized entry. Automated systems save NWR money for being allocated to other programs. Well, sometimes it does save money, sometimes it doesn't. But, because you got to look at the big picture for maintenance and long-term stuff, you'll be happy to know, this is from, thank you for your valued suggestion, you'll be happy to know that SCENIC, that's Navy Installations Command, is in the process of procuring new ticketing movie kiosks for the theaters. Please be aware, this may take some time, but it is in the work. So we recognize that. I'm a big fan of ticket kiosks. They have them all over the states as well. You just touch screen your way into the movie you want. Of course, it'll be easy here because you're going to get one, and one theater type of thing. And so with that, I think we'll take a quick break.
MWR is online. They can purchase tickets online now from MWR.
Purchase tickets online. We're trying to work so you can purchase a lot of things online, like your swim lessons. Sign up for your other stuff. There is an app, all Navy app for MWR, where you can pull down the installation. So if you're a kind of an Apple user, iPhone user, I think it works for Android as well, just use that for going online, looking at what's going on in the theaters and everything else, Navy MWR. So we are trying to go automate and make our lives easier here. Right? So with that, we're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back in just a few.
Hi there, Yokosuka. Would you like to see some of our previous stories or keep in touch with us with stories that we're going to publish in the future? Come and join us on our YouTube page at AFN_Yokosuka at youtube.com. On the page, you can see old news stories that we've released,
when moving this exercise forward.
Informational videos that can help you with your time out here in Yokosuka, and personnel features that feature sailors from around the base.
Tech, diagnose, and treat.
So go ahead and join the AFN Yokosuka family today.
Welcome back, Yokosuka, Akago, Parts Unknown, tuning in from all the place. Captain Dave Glenister, Master Chief Marty King, returning with your ice comments and some news you can use, some of those things. We'll try and do this a little more often. I keep saying that, but you know, we'd like to build these up to where you get a good body of comments that we can kind of come back at you with. So a couple things. In the first half of the program, we talked about passports. We talked about tourist passports and how that's not the government's problem. It's your problem. It's my problem for my own tourist passport as well. And we said the DS-11. Yes, it is the DS-11 form. You can download those. You go to state.gov. One, you look at your tourist advisories. One, you can get your passport type stuff. You can Google U.S. passport form, and it'll come up. But it's the DS-11. You can pre-fill those out, get your appointment at the embassy, and you're good. A couple of other comments here. Thrift store. You know we have a thrift store? Navy Marine Corps Relief. Thank you very much to them for opening that thing up. They do take donations, and they do have sales. You got to stay attuned to when those are. They want to expand the hours. They certainly have the interest. What they don't have is the volunteers, necessarily. So if you are so inclined. Now, I will tell you that it is not lost on me that many people come here. They may have been working professionals, and now they can't. Because, let's face it, the government of Japan is not too keen on us bringing in a bunch of people into their workforce when they're already trying to employ their own people. And that's why you just can't go work as a paralegal at a Japanese law firm, language barrier aside, and all those things. But volunteering at some of these things do look good on the resume. It does show a continuity of employment. If you work at Navy Marine Corps Relief Society, USO, Red Cross, all these other activities and organizations. But back to the thrift shop. Please, do not just dump stuff out there. It goes into the trash, right? Because they're not going to take stuff off the curb. They can't. And they have their standard operating procedures as to why. And they run thrift shops everywhere. It's not like a local thing. Don't just leave stuff outside. It's going in the dumpster. So you may as well put it in the dumpster, which I would wish you would not do anyway, because there's some things that are worthy of recycling and worthy of using. So please coordinate your drop-off times with them. I know PCS season, people want to do that. So please be a good neighbor. Please be a good member of the community here and do that. Don't dump your trash on base, too. There's an uptick in trash, people throwing wrappers and cans. I tell you, the only thing that really cheeses me off is when I go into, because I do, I have to reach into a bush to pull a can out. There's only one way it happened, and that's if somebody intentionally shoved it in there. I mean, I can see little wrappers at the corner of your child's candy gets blown around. So please keep the base looking good. Just use the trash cans we have and do that stuff. A comment I had made earlier about the kind of the DXM and some kids get in trouble. So this is a note to parents. Finals are here for those of you who are taking finals. And so be aware of your kids' stress. But the grades. I want to talk about unexcused absences and your kids' grades. You as a parent should be aware of what's going on in your kids' lives. And that's, it doesn't matter if they're 35 or they're 5. I mean, you will always be their parent. So you should be involved, you should be aware of what's going on. That's just Dave Glenister's theory on parenting. But you know, be aware of how they're doing in their grades. You should be getting emails from your teachers about what their grades are. I get them all the time. You can go onto Schoolology and look that stuff up. But also, what are their number of absences? And I will tell you, I can predict with uncanny accuracy whether your child is going to be in trouble and going to go to a civilian administrative form based on the number of unexcused absences and how their grades decline. Grades tend to decline because when you first take your first quiz, everyone gets an A on it. Right? And it's not until you really get through most couple months you really see the grades. But they start going down. If you're pulling D's and F's and you've got 10 unexcused absences as of January, your child is heading into trouble. And I don't mean in school. I mean they're either hanging around with the wrong friends or they are doing something they shouldn't be doing. They are standing into danger. You have to be involved. And this whole thing about, well, I work really hard, we're both military parents, we're both doing whatever, I got it, but you must be involved. And you know, and so that's my 2-minute plea to be involved in your kids' lives. If you see that, just ask those questions over dinner. You know, ask them about their friends, where they're going, what they're doing, why are these unexcused absences, why were you late, why were you not there? Sometimes there's reasons. But when you have that many, it's a pattern. So be aware of those patterns and help keep us kids in the straight and narrow. Finally, winter is upon us. We had some great weather. Sometimes I think global warming ain't all bad when we're, you know, I'm outside in a t-shirt in late December. But I believe in karma also, and that's all going to be paid for, and I think it's going to be paid for in February. And of course, you know, the United States as well is having these cold snaps, as we call them. So winter advisory. So we actually had someone call and say, is the base closed? The base, I don't close the base, because that sends the wrong message. It can be misinterpreted. Okay. There are times, if the roads are impassable, the most restrictive I ever get is I close the roads to vehicular traffic that is not mission essential, which means if you're not part of clearing the snow or the debris from a typhoon, get off the roads. Now, when you show up at the gate, you know, I'm not going to make you drive back home through all this nonsense. We'll say, come in, get to where you're going, and stop, hunker down, kind of thing there. So if you ask if the base is closed, the answer will almost assuredly be no. The key is to coordinate with your tenant commands. So whether it be a typhoon or snow or whatever, you know, when in command, command. Your command will decide whether or not you're going to need to come in or not. And so call them if they're going to do a delayed start or something like that. We will place onto Facebook, right, our public affairs page, and elsewhere, we'll do what the computer desktop notification system, those emails that we send to you, and those kind of things. We will put out there any of those kind of winter advisories, snow advisories. The marquee we have right now is broken, and we actually we have the parts coming in to fix that thing. It makes me sad, you know, because I like to use that thing for this type of emergency thing when you're at the gate. But stay attuned. Get yourself a good weather app to see what's happening. It's really, you know, if you stay attuned to what's happening with the public transportation system out in town, you'll have a pretty good feel of how bad things are. And we do try to put those out on the Base Commander's channel, where you're watching this possibly, and onto some of those advisories and Facebook, how public transportation is being closed, how the toll roads, which are privately owned toll roads, are closed, and those things. So if you don't see any of that stuff, then probably we're good. But when in doubt, call your command. You know, just like you would back at home. If you work for a deli and you don't know if you should come to work, call your boss. Do I have to come in? Yeah, you do. There you go. All right. So I love the emotional, mostly charged ICE comments here. I continue to be amazed on how the NEX is allowed to get away with fraud. I love it. Fraud on transactions and false advertising. Today my total should have been $33.98, and instead it was $34. Okay. I will file a complaint with the Better Business Bureau in the near future, as I and many other sailors are constantly being wronged and taken advantage of. Well, if your bill was $34.02 and it ended up being $34, you probably wouldn't go to extraordinary lengths to turn it into pennies. So here's the deal. And, you know, you can agree with what you want. I was equally stunned, I suppose, 10 years ago. I'd grown to accept it. It costs a lot of money to ship pennies. Actually, it costs more than a penny to make a penny, even. But neither here nor there. It costs a lot of money to ship pennies. The only time you'll actually probably get pennies, I think, is at the post office, because legally, as a federal government, they have to give you your change back fully. But it's very expensive to ship a lot of pennies. So overseas, you know, and this is consistent with MWR, the NEX, the commissary, we either round up or round down. And it ends up being a bit of a wash either way. You know, so it's not that big a deal. So no, rounding down or rounding up the amount of pennies is not only legal, but that's what we do here. Okay, so you're not getting wronged here. So, but the comment is: rest assured, there's no fraud occurring in rounding up and rounding down of change. According to MWR Yokosuka director, none of Japan's MWR operations use pennies. That's across all Japan in their operations. Also, Yokosuka commissary director confirmed it, and the commissaries round change to the nearest nickel. Okay. Rounding up or down change to the closest nickel provides savings to the U.S. taxpayer. DECA nor AFEES, like the NEX, change their CONUS prices to account for the rounding change so our customers enjoy CONUS pricing while stationed in Japan. So basically, there's no fraud. There's nothing illegal. Over time, you'll find it probably works itself out. Okay. So there you go. But I thought I'd mention that. It hasn't come up in a while. But I assume you're new. Welcome to Yokosuka. So,
Ah, since pets have now been allowed on the first and second floors of towers, we've witnessed several pet owners allowing their dogs to drop feces in the grassy areas of the courtyard and leave it there. We now have to walk carefully along the courtyard to avoid stepping in any feces. This is unacceptable and needs to be addressed and corrected immediately. We are former pet owners and know all too well of the importance of the simple task to avoid diseases, viruses, or just uncleanness. Please address the issue. Thank you in advance. Yeah, so one, you should address with your neighbors as well. Call them out on it. I am absolutely supportive of you narking on them. And you're a former pet owner. So unless they want to be also former pet owners, they need to follow the rules that we have around here to do that. So as you have alluded to, we have now allowed dogs on the first and second floor of all of our towers. That was a policy that I kind of stepped into, no pun intended, stepped into lightly, knowing it has been tried at non-Navy installations and failed because of hygiene things and people on the upper floors not following the rules. And then you have, you know, defecation in the elevators and stuff like that because the dogs can't make it outside. And it becomes bad from health and other perspectives. So I wanted to make sure that I had a good understanding of the level of complaints I was going to get. But I mean, legitimate, not just, you know, the dogs barking, but I mean hygienic things that I now have to resolve. So, and this is one of those. So as you're aware, is our response, our official response. Pet ownership is a conditional privilege, and pet owners are responsible for removing their pets' excrements immediately after excretion anywhere on board Fleet Activity Yokosuka, including the Ikego detachment, which I guess is where this takes place. Responsible behavior must be exhibited in control of pets or pet owners, or they'll be subject to the privileges being revoked. We won't take your pet away. We'll make you figure out how to no longer have a pet, send it back home or whatever. Our inspectors are regularly checking the common areas and the grounds to ensure conformance to housing regulations. However, if you witness any residents who are not adhering to the existing pet policies, please contact your housing inspector at 243-6784 or CFA Security at 243-2300. And we'll continue to monitor and educate the residents. So, and about responsible pet ownership. But I would expand this comment also to any other kind of residential issues that you have, whether it be people, you know, your neighbors that smoke and you don't want them to smoke, and you're trying to work it out with them. People dropping trash, illegally dumping, you know, whether it be a car battery. I think it's a comment on that one here. Someone left a car battery somewhere because some people don't care. All those types of things. To teenagers who are, there's no such thing as teenagers being teenagers by stealing someone's bicycle or doing something. Okay, that is being a non-productive member of society that I will handle in my own way if you can actually help me report this. So absolutely, I want you to narc on your neighbors if they are doing something illegal. Because if you don't do something, if you don't say something to those teenagers, I say teenagers because this has been, people have approached me and said, we have teenagers that do this stuff. And I said, did you, you know, call security? Well, no, I don't want to get them in trouble. Then why are you telling the base CO, who you now expect me to hunt them down and get them in trouble? What you don't want to do is you don't want to somehow create some kind of bad blood between you and someone else. Takes a village to raise a child. We all have responsibility. Absolutely. If you don't do something, you just reset the level from legal to whatever's going on. You have now acquiesced to this, let's not say lawlessness, that'll be too dramatic, but, you know, miscreant behavior, I don't know. Okay, so call people out. One, call them out on the spot, and then, you know, yes, call security on them, and we will try and take this thing for action. I don't mean to sound like we're going to, you know, everyone's going to get their pitchforks and torches and have some kind of, you know, Nico Tower versus Issei Tower kind of moment or something like that, but, you know, we have a responsibility to, I don't say self-police, but, you know, we don't know about who these people are unless you tell us. And nor can we shake everybody down to figure out who it was. So if you want something to happen, and I want something to happen, please call us and tell us. Okay, here's another one that if I could raise one eyebrow, I would. I do not like being approached about, this is for the Purdy Fitness Center. I do not like being approached about not being able to bring any food into the gym. If I am an adult and I'm feeling the need to have a snack, I should be able to make that decision myself. I would say yes, as long as you made the right decision to not do it. After working all day, it is not conducive for me to eat at home and then plan to go to the gym. Well, you know what? This is just stupid. I don't care. Follow the rules, all right? This is absolutely absurd. You know? You're an adult and you feel like you can blow off the rules and bring food in the gym? Stop going to my gym. Go somewhere else. I don't care. This is ridiculous. You know, there are rules. You don't get to pick and choose what they are. There are sanitation and other reasons why you can't. Why don't you eat on the park bench outside? And then please use a trash can to throw your trash away. And then you can come in. But don't go swimming a half hour after you eat. Get a cramp. All right? So, yes, there is no food allowed, and I don't care if you don't like it. I'm not to be really mean about it, but does anyone else not? I mean, you guys are off camera. They're shaking their heads, too. So, yeah. I'm an adult. I should be able to break your rules without someone telling me I'm breaking the rules. That's basically what I'm reading into this thing. You know? I don't know. I wasn't being sarcastic.
There's a rule, you follow it. If you don't like the rule, then you address the people who makes the rule and whether it should be changed or not. It's there for reasons.
That's right. So here's the deal. In life, if you don't like the rule, complain about it and then change it. But if you can't change it, toe the party line. All right? That's what you do in your commands. You know, that's you try and protest, come with a better idea. But if that's not the idea, then get on board. Okay. Sending along some positive words for the MAs and security guards at Akego. While they're all professional and courteous, we particularly look forward to seeing Azehara-san at the gate. His positive attitude, friendly greetings, and enthusiastic salute always puts a smile on our face. So thanks to all the friendly folks manning the gate at Akego in the cold. So we pass that on to Azehara-san. Always nice to hear that. A lot of professionalism in that force and doing a good job. So I know exactly what you mean. So, and I tell you, it does put you in the right, I'd say, frame of mind when you're greeted with professionalism. I don't say, you know, happy, happy, joy, joy, laugh and joking. I mean, sometimes when you go to some bases around the world and, man, even the people who are directing traffic just look like a very highly professional automaton. I mean, they are so snappy. I'm thinking of a place in Korea in particular. I was like, holy cow. You know, sometimes they're Korean, sometimes they're U.S., just like we have here. And it really does make you want to, you know, tuck in your shirt and stand up straighter. You know, when you're greeted with that. Or, you know, when you're greeted with courteousness and a smile, it puts you in a better mood. So thank you very much to our gate guards. I appreciate your comment. This is for the Navy Lodge. Jasmine, one of our front desk attendants, did a super job helping us complete our medical orders TDY reservation at the Navy Lodge today. She was courteous, professional, and very helpful in answering our questions. I hope that she'll be recognized in a special way for her outstanding commitment to her work. And on the air, forever in the digital footprint, now she's been recognized. So thank you, Jasmine. So thank you very much for your feedback. It is always a pleasure to hear when our staff has exceeded the expectations of our guests. I will definitely commend Jasmine on her job well done. We look forward to having you as our guest soon. And that's from Brendan Collin, the general manager, out there doing great things at the Navy Lodge, which, as you know, either does or soon will allow pets in some rooms.
Yes, I can't remember how many rooms they're going to make pet friendly, but they are.
Can't make them all because some people have pet allergies, right? So once the NGIS made the decision that they will be able to do that, then that enabled Navy Lodge to follow local policy and put this in motion. So we're very happy or excited that that's going to happen too. It'll help relieve the burden of kennels and things like that. And this is one of the, actually, she is a school teacher. She used to be one of my kids' school teachers, and she has PCS, accepted a position somewhere else. So congratulations to her. But on her way out the door, she basically put in a whole bunch of these things to a whole bunch of different agencies to thank them. And she even thanked AmeriCable, the staff, for being courteous, polite, and helpful through tech support. I mean, you may not like their service, but the people are good people. So thank you to the housing department in Akego. You've all been extremely helpful and kind during my family's tour in Japan. Thank you for accommodating my schedule when it comes to maintenance inspections and appointments. And thank you very much for your comment. And, you know, this particular, I happen to know this person. She was the day teacher, worked long hours, single mom. And, you know, so sometimes her schedule was kind of hectic. And so people, you know, she recognized a lot of the things she had here. So thank you very much to her. And she goes on to a lot of different places too. This is for the Starbucks. I think this is the comment we talked about. Probably the best run retail establishment on the base. And thank you very much. The employees are friendly, motivated, efficient, and professional. The only complaint is that some of the upholstered furniture in the carpet in the corners is got to go. It's full of stains. It's worn. Past useful life. Please replace it. And as we have mentioned, actually tonight, pardon me, still getting over my my annual winter cold. It's supposed to be scheduled for tonight, January 22nd. Sometimes those things shift, but they're going to be working at night to not impact you. And hopefully, you're going to get a little refresh. It'll go good. So this one I want to comment on as well. This is for the Officers Club. I want to take a minute to express my disappointment that the O Club did not offer entertainment on New Year's Eve. And it goes on to, got a 5-minute sign there. It goes on to say how it's MWR's job to provide morale, welfare, and recreation. That is in our mission statement, and we know that. But actually, this particular individual has also stacked the deck in the other direction with his comments.
Yes.
But I'll just go on to say that we have tried. So this is New Year's Eve, and we do have things at the clubs. In this case, I think the only thing we had was the bar at the O Club, because we had things at Club Alliance. Great fireworks show off base, Vernie Ogre Park. We opened the Dye Gate so you could go out there and come back easily, because that is a disaster trying to come back on base right after that's over, because the Japanese tend to go off and pray for a good New Year right at after midnight. The base in large did a lot of things. And here's the comment back to you as far as New Year's Eve goes. We've tried numerous different activities for New Year's Eve celebrations, including bands, DJs, gourmet dinners, but unfortunately it's very poorly attended. Due to past usage, the decision was made to only keep the bar open. So we do track usage, we do those things, and we even tried to get some entertainment. No one was interested in playing on New Year's Eve. Either they had another gig or they felt like celebrating themselves. So we look at usership.
We had that issue across all the clubs.
Yeah.
And our MWR Entertainment Office, which schedules all that, actually did have an extremely hard time trying to get anything from outside, because all of our bands come from outside. Also, on that other side, over the last couple of years, usership on those particular special nights has declined significantly.
So I think, it is a huge holiday. It's the biggest holiday in Japan. So if trying to get all of our entertainment, they got their own thing going on, right? It's a big family holiday, and it starts early and ends about, 12:01. I mean, after New Year's, fireworks show, everything else, you watch the streets and everybody clears out. They go off to a temple or a shrine, they pray for a good New Year, and they button everything up. So, not surprising. It's like trying to get a bunch of people to come play on Thanksgiving when, it's difficult because everyone in America is also doing their own family thing. So I would encourage you, and when these things kind of come up in the future, try and there's a lot going on. It just wasn't right there. So anyway, this is for Public Works. Garbage recycling pickup services between 6 and 7 a.m. on Saturdays and Sundays is very disruptive in the housing areas. They're in Issei Heights is the particular one. And extremely loud when recycling is picked up, and the aluminum cans, bottles crashing, it wakes everybody up. Got that stuff. Quiet hours is typically until 8 a.m., and so please respect that. And so our comments, thank you. You are absolutely correct, and your comments are very much appreciated. So we have contacted the contractor, informed them trash pickup should commence no sooner than 0800 and follow the installation quiet hours. And they've regret the inconvenience that it has caused you and your neighbors. So there you go. Comment, action taken. We're going to move to after 0. And so if that happens again, please tell us and we'll take this thing going. A shout out to Petty Officer McDonald, I believe was his name, for coming to Tsubaki Tower on a particular time. And a school morning and sighting and turning around people using the Tsubaki Shobu parking lot as a school drop-off area. Even though there are signs stating the parking lot isn't a drop-off zone, people use it daily. And as they go to Sullivan's each day, I've seen people speeding through the parking lot, drop off the kids, instead of the drop-off zone, and safety and everything else. Yes, and those of you who may have been approached by security and said, hey, we saw you going through here, there's a few of us people you have to thank for that. And I am one of them. So I occasionally go through there, and I write down your license plate, and I say, you were in this thing at this time, give them a ticket, because I don't have to put up with that stuff. Follow the rules. We've doubled the points in the school zone. So you get two moving violations, a parking violation, you lose your license for a year. And you know what is hilarious? If these people who appeal their license or something on the basis that, come to find out, it's really inconvenient to not have a license. Well, yes, especially the ones like a DUI or something. And, well, you know, half of my workforce, Japanese workforce, does not have a car on base. They use public transportation and they walk. And you get to live that dream if you break the rules. So, yes, and also don't swear at the safety patrol. It goes back to being a good example for your kids. You know, if you start using profanity or even just talking back or talking down to a 9 or a 10-year-old child in front of your own child, you just tell them that you have no respect for people, and that's not good. So don't do that. You know, follow the rules. It doesn't matter if it's raining. Doesn't matter if it's windy. Whatever you think, how your situation somehow overrides the rules, I'm here to tell you, it doesn't. So, yes, thank you for that. We will have our plain clothes people out there. We will occasionally give you tickets. We can't be there every day. And that is the whole point of some of these speed traps and things. It's that we can't be every day. You'll never know. You know, you'll just never see us coming. You'll just, you know, we'll call you. We'll call you into security and give you a ticket. So let's see. For Outdoor Rec, thanks for all the people who manage Outdoor Rec. Keep up the good work. They're doing great things. How come there's not many, this is for MDR Entertainment, how come there's not many R&B groups or functions here? Rock and roll country groups always seem to be the agenda, nothing more. Actually, Trey Songz, T-Pain, Nelly was out here, but they're contracted through the Armed Forces Entertainment, which is Pacific Air Force folks, and we don't really have a say. But I would say, excuse me again, of the folks that come here, we pretty much get them all, seeing as we are so large. So if they're coming, they generally come here. And we've had some good cover bands, and we've had some good actual bands, you know, Three Doors Down and some other folks as well. So we try and get some entertainment. We don't control that. Let's see if there's anything else good. Oh, I think we'll probably wrap this one up after this one because we're almost out of time. We talked about buses in Ikego. There's one issue about parking in Ikego. We took away a bunch of parking spots because it's the fire lane. Here's what happened. Street wasn't wide enough. Got to have 20 feet. And it's only 16 feet wide.
Oh, okay.
Had to take away the parking spots.
Yeah.
All right. This happened very early in December. A lot of stuff's quieted down, but you can't. You know, cannot break the fire rules. Yes, it came to our attention. Yes, we've been breaking the rules a long time. And, you know, we go periodically. We survey things, see if we need to put in a stop sign, take out a stop sign. Turns out we were in violation of all these in Ikego, this common spot, and so we took them out. So that's the answer. May not be satisfying, but that's the answer.
Can't get the fire trucks through.
Yeah, got it. I mean, yeah, I have to do that one. You know, I can't. That's a rule that even if I could bend it, I'm not gonna. All right, so here's one for the gate guard security. During the playing of the national anthem this morning, there were two military members in the far right gate speaking with a driver of a vehicle, moving around and making generic hand gestures. Near the end of the anthem, one of them handed the driver's ID card back, and then both sailors enter the gate building instead of coming to attention and rendering a proper salute. Okay, so just like a working party or something else, no, our gate guards do not stop for the national anthem. One, it happens every day, and you'd know exactly when these guys have their back turned, or gals, to render honors. They do not, for a very good reason, force protection, security, and everything else. So that's not, they are on point all the time, right? So that is not a foul, there's no flag on that play. They are absolutely, in fact, I would jack them up if they did render honors for the national anthem because their job is to be keeping their eyes on all the people there. So due to force protection being our utmost responsibility, we remain vigilant in ensuring our posture is towards the ECP, keeping alert. Our gate sentries have been instructed to not observe colors while standing the sentry. If the sentry was to turn around and face the ensign, that's the flag, national ensign, they would not be able to ensure the safety of those that live and work on our base. So this is, you know, again, I just kind of make the point emphatically because sometimes people do that. They call us out and say, hey, how come, you know, we didn't lower the Japanese flag to half-mast? And it's like, well, because we're in Japan and we don't lower anyone else's flags. So sometimes there is, you know, because we're new here, or not new, but it's new to some folks, people say, hey, you know, no flag flies higher than the American flag, which is true in America, okay, but we're not in America. And so there are some subtle differences. You got to kind of read some of the footnotes in some of the U.S. code. And this is one of those times where we say, hey, everyone's supposed to stop at the national anthem. Well, there are some footnotes in some of those rules, and one of those is force protection, gate guard security. There's a whole bunch of others, but that's one of them. So not to make someone coming down on you, but just want to make sure that, you know, we're clear. Our guys did a good job. Thank you for pointing that out, and now everybody knows. So with that, I will say, you know, we're coming up on 3-day weekend time after time. Have a plan for that. Enjoy it. Spend some time with your kids. You know, have a plan for them to get them out of the house and not just spend all the time on the video games. Maybe take a trip somewhere where it is a day off for the Americans, but not for the Japanese. You can actually, you know, make the most of some of those low-attended places because you're the only game in town. Make the most of it. Have a plan for that. And with that, we'll see you around the base. Have a happy January.